Well, good morning, everybody. We'd just like to welcome you all to the service today. Something wee bit different, being over Zoom because of the lockdown. But we'd just like to welcome you all and hope you get a blessing from this sermon. I'll get into it. A month or so ago, we had our church camp. And while on our afternoon walk, I took this photo that you see here with the title of the sermon on it. This photo was the inspiration for the sermon. When I looked at this photo, I saw how it represented our lives. We travel through life, represented here by the steps. But for many people, the future or the destination can be a little hazy or even unknown. So, what is our future or destination? So before we begin, I'd just like to say a prayer. We just bow our heads. And Heavenly Father, we'd just like to thank you that we can meet together here on the Sabbath, even though it's not in person. We're meeting over Zoom with modern technology that can allow us to do this. And we just ask that the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us that are listening, and may we all get a blessing from the message. We just pray this in your name. Amen. Recently, while listening to some songs on YouTube, a certain song came on. It was a song I'd never heard before, but the words really struck me because it dealt with death, and it, along with this photo I took, really inspired me for this talk. The song is "If I Had Only a Chance," and it's by the group BZN. The song talks about two kids, there's a brother and a sister, waiting one cold morning down at the harbour to pick up their father, who was returning from sea, to celebrate his birthday with them. As the winds increased and the clouds darkened in the sky, an old fisherman told them of a boat at sea sending out an SOS. The boat never returned, and the sailors were never found. The words of the chorus go like this: "We've been waiting so long, oh Daddy, what went wrong? How we need you now and beg you, please come home. If I had only a chance to see your face again, tears that I cried, they would blind me on and on. If I had only a chance to hear your voice again, words that you whispered would seem to be a song. Time cures all things, and years are passing by, but still I can hear my sister cry, I've been waiting so long. Oh Daddy, what went wrong? How I need you now, I beg you please come home." We've all lost someone and wish we could be with that person again, because you miss them. We want to see them and hear their voice again. Why did things go wrong? Life can be hard. Life can sometimes feel like an uphill battle, as depicted in my photo. And then, in the end, we die. When you look around, you'll see people that have what seems like an easy life. They have lots of money. They always seem to be traveling. Big fancy houses, nice car. And they have whatever they want. Then there are others that don't have much. They struggle to find the money to pay the bills. There are many, many people who have suffered atrocities in their lives throughout all of history, through wars or violence of some sort. And it includes wars in the name of religion. However, it doesn't matter where you are in life. We all have problems. Everyone has. Everyone is suffering or will suffer grief or struggles of some sort. And you may wonder what life is all about. What's the point? Because after all this, you die. Where has this journey of life taken us? When someone dies, this can bring about questions for people. Many people have questions such as, what is death? Where are they now? Are they now in another better place? Are they happy? Are they reunited with someone they've lost? Or others may ask, are they asleep, waiting the resurrection? Or others may ask, are they just gone, dead, nothing? Others may believe in reincarnation, which they will come back as someone else or as an animal. There are many beliefs. So what does happen when we die? Is there life after we die? Or is this the end? Are there answers, or we just don't know? As a Christian, we can have the hope of eternal life, but is this just fantasy or blind faith, a hope we have? Maybe we're not even 100% sure that it will happen. The Bible tells us about heaven, about eternal life, but just because the Bible says this, can we be sure it's true? The Bible is known as the Word of God, and that it has power to transform lives, and it has transformed lives of people. So I thought I might start with just a few fun facts about the Bible. Some interesting facts about the Bible are, there are 365 verses that tell us not to fear. So that means there's one verse for every day. The Bible has 40 authors written in three continents. There's Asia, Africa, and Europe, and written originally in Hebrew, Greek, and Arabic, made up with 66 books. The Old Testament took over 1,500 years to write, and the New Testament was written over a period of 50 to 75 years. As of 2019, the Bible has been translated into 698 different languages, and the New Testament into 1,548 languages. The verse in the exact center is Psalm 118 and verse 8. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put your confidence in man. The Bible is the best-selling book of all time, and it is estimated that 25 million copies are sold in the United States alone. 100 million around the world. It is also the most shoplifted. So what is the main message of the Bible? The main message of the Bible is that God is restoring the world back to his original design, and this is through his son, Jesus Christ. The world is in a state of brokenness because of man's rejection of God. Jesus came into this broken and hurting, sinful world to die, to pay the price for our sin and restoring us back to God. The first three chapters of the Bible talk about creation of earth and of man, and then the fall of man. In the beginning, God created the world, and he gave man the job to care for the world, in Genesis 1:28. Man then went and disobeyed God, thereby rejecting God. This resulted in death for man. Romans 6 and verse 23, in the first part, it says, for the wages of sin is death. However, God gave a promise of a saviour, and this was found in Genesis 3:15. The good news about the saviour is that we can have eternal life, and it is a free gift. In Romans 6:23, in the last part, it says, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, this restoration process was introduced to the Israelites, who were to learn God's ways and become a blessing to all nations and to teach all nations about God. Then Jesus came into this world, the Son of God, born as a man. His message was the gospel, or the good news of the kingdom of God, restoration back to God. Jesus died on the cross, and this paid for the penalty of sin. In 1 Peter 3:18, in the first part, it said, Christ also suffered when he died for our sins once for all time. He never sinned, but he died for sinners that he might bring us safely home to God. Jesus said after his resurrection that all authority in heaven and earth had been given to him. In Matthew 28:18, Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given complete authority in heaven and earth. The good news of the gospel is that we can be restored back to God and have eternal life in God's kingdom, where there is no sickness, war, famine, death, violence, or heartache. The cross is where God showed his love for man. Jesus died to pay for the penalty of sin and to reconcile man to God. Jesus laid down his life as a sacrifice. The death on the cross and the blood that was shed for sin is what brings forgiveness of sin and pays the price so that we are redeemed by God and restored to him. Jesus told him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." John 14:6-7. The final part of the message of the Bible is that Jesus is coming again, coming back as a king, first to take his people back to heaven, then to restore his kingdom on earth. Jesus comes to replace the kingdoms of this world with God's kingdom. He will remove all sin from the earth. God will once again dwell with men on earth. Revelation 21:1-4. And it says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God.'" Verse 5, it says, "And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new. All evil will ultimately be removed from earth.'" The message of the Bible is that there is hope in this world where we experience pain and brokenness. The hope of the Bible is that Jesus is returning to restore God's plan for the world. The Bible calls for people to believe in Jesus, God's Son, who died for their sin. In John 3:16-17, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in the order that the world might be saved through him." The Bible then is all about God and how he is trying to restore a relationship with people. It is also about the death and resurrection of his Son, the promised Saviour, that makes this possible. And then the last three chapters is life restored back to how God created it. We have all sinned. Every one of us in this world are guilty of sinning. And the bad news is, the Bible says the wages of sin is death. But the good news is that because of his love for us, Jesus made the decision that he would pay the price for sin. When the universe saw Christ die on the cross, that was when God's character of love was truly seen. In Philippians 2:7-8, "But made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross." Revelation 1:5, in the last half, "Unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood." This is talking about Jesus and his death. This is the only reason why we can have the opportunity of eternal life. Do you wonder whether your sins are too bad to be forgiven? Do you wonder whether maybe you've gone too far? You've done too many things that are bad. We've all sinned, and the good news is that Jesus' blood is able to cleanse us from our sins. His blood has power to cleanse us, no matter what we've done, no matter how bad our past is. However, the other important thing we have to consider is his resurrection. Without Christ's resurrection, we would not be resurrected and have eternal life. Our faith would be in vain. in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17 to 22. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hoped in Christ, we of all people most pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man also came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. Did Christ actually resurrect from the dead? Can it be true? Because if there was no resurrection, then all our faith is in vain. There's one thing that distinguishes Christianity from every other religion. All religions maintain that their founders lived, that they taught certain doctrines, but their founder died and they stayed dead. The Christian religion is the only one that maintains its founder was raised from the dead and is still alive today and lives forever. The Christian movement would have died at Christ's death if he didn't rise from the dead. The resurrection is so important. If the resurrection didn't happen, then Christianity is a sham, and our hope of eternal life, as promised in the Bible, is just a dream or a fantasy. If Jesus didn't arise, then we may as well just live our lives how we want, whether good or bad, with no regard for anyone else. Because in the end, what does it matter? Because in the end, we just die. So just have the best life now, even if it means stepping on others in the process. However, if Christ was raised from the dead, then we, as promised, can be raised from the dead also. Our lives do have a purpose, and we can live our lives, and our lives do matter. It means there is a judgment. There is eternal life. Once we are called at the resurrection, at Christ's second coming, this life then has meaning. In 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 and 17, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of a trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Also in 1 Corinthians 15, 52 to 50, verse 52, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. The Bible says that if Christ didn't rise from the dead, there is no hope for the dead, but because Jesus lives, we can live too. If Christ did rise from the dead, then that means everything Christ taught was true. Therefore, everything he said about himself was true. And everything he said about life after death was also true. We can rest in the hope of eternal life if Jesus is who he says he is. His resurrection confirms that he is who he said he is. So it's obviously very important that Christ actually resurrected from the dead. Can we rely on just blind faith? I personally don't think so, as I, along with many other people, I'd imagine, like facts or something to be shown as true. So I want to look into the resurrection, get some facts, so we can make an informed decision on the validity of his resurrection. This is so important because if it can't be shown that there is a resurrection from the dead, then the Christian faith is no more true or relevant than any other religion, idea or belief, including atheism. So is it possible to show the resurrection did actually happen? I believe you can. I'm only going to show a few examples because of time. It can be shown that Jesus was a real person, and in fact, most historians and scholars agree that Jesus was alive, was a real person, and that he died on a Roman cross. When studying ancient history, we are lucky to have one or two sources to confirm a fact. But for Jesus' death, there are multiple early first century accounts in the New Testament, but also there are five ancient sources outside of the Bible confirming Christ's death. They know that he received a burial, an honourable burial, where Joseph of Arimathea, who was a member of the Sanhedrin and also a secret supporter of Christ, gave his tomb for Christ. This means that the site of the tomb was known to all. Christ wasn't thrown into a common grave with other criminals. When the woman came to this known tomb to anoint his body, they found that the tomb was empty and the door was rolled open. This had been sealed and guarded. The enemies of Jesus admitted that the tomb was empty because when the disciples began proclaiming that Jesus had risen, they didn't say, "Well, let's just go and open the grave and see." They said that the disciples had stolen the body. Therefore, they knew that the grave was empty. But how did it get empty? The Romans wouldn't steal it because they wanted him dead. They had made sure he was dead before they buried him. The Jewish leaders wouldn't steal the body. They wanted him to stay dead. The disciples wouldn't have stolen the body because they didn't have the motive, the means, or the opportunity to steal it. It was guarded, plus they were hiding. They were fearful for their lives. The only other conclusion would be that Christ rose from the dead, as he said he would. Another thing is that there were eyewitnesses. The disciples saw Jesus alive after his death. He appeared to them individually. He also appeared to groups of people. In fact, one group was about 500 people. He appeared to skeptics like his brother James, and he also appeared to Saul of Tarsus, who was a persecutor of the church. They touched him, they ate, and they talked with him. Maybe they had hallucination, but this doesn't explain an empty tomb. You can hallucinate a dead person being alive, but the body would still be in the tomb. The other problem is that there was a huge number of people that saw Christ. One person can hallucinate, but a group of people hallucinating the same thing doesn't happen. Hallucination is an individual thing. The resurrection also changed the lives of the disciples. We know that when Jesus was being crucified, that the disciples were hiding. They were fearful and they were afraid. They were afraid that they were also going to be executed, so they hid. Yet we know that soon after, in the same city as Jesus was put to death, they were now proclaiming with boldness that Jesus not only was the Son of God, but they backed up that claim by saying that he was raised from the dead. But the most important thing is that they were willing to proclaim this to their death. They suffered a lot throughout their ministry, and even right up to being put to death, they still proclaimed his resurrection. And this is because they saw him alive. This is just a small list of evidences for the resurrection. And because we have a lot of evidence that Christ did rise from the dead, then we have that assurance that what Jesus said, we know that we can believe him. We have the assurance that he is the Son of God and that he did come and die for us and our sins are forgiven. We also become the children of God. In John 1 and verse 12, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. We also have this promise in 1 John 5 and verse 13. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. So what are some of the things that the Bible says about heaven and eternal life? Jesus said that he has gone to prepare a place for us. heaven has mentions and that he will be there with us. In John 14, verse 2, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. Heaven is a place where we will worship God and Jesus. Revelation 7, 9 to 11, after this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshipped God. Heaven will be filled with peace, joy, and praise. Revelation 7, 15 to 17. Therefore they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. There shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor scorching heat. For the Lamb is in the midst of the throne, will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Here are some texts about what heaven in the New Jerusalem will look like. There'll be precious gemstones will adorn heaven. Revelation 21, 10 to 11. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, its radiance like the most rare jewel, like a jasper, clear as crystal. Verse 18 to 20. The wall was built of jasper, while the city was pure gold, clear as glass. The foundations of the wall of the city were adorned with every kind of jewel. The first was jasper, the second sapphire, the third agate, the fourth emerald. The list of gems goes on. Heaven will have pearl gates and the streets of gold. Revelation 21, 21. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Each of the gates were made of a single pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold, transparent as glass. Revelation 21 goes on to say that in heaven there will be no more sun or moon. The glory of God and the light of the Lamb will be its illumination. Revelation 21, 23. The tree of life will be in heaven. Revelation 22, 2. Through the middle of the street of the city, also on either side of the river, the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. The leaves of the tree will be for the healing of the nations. We will see God's face. We will reign forever. In Revelation 22, 4 and 5, they will see his face and his name will be on their foreheads. The night will be no more. They will need no light or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. For many people, the following verse will bring great comfort. Revelation 21, 4. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away. Only through Christ's death and resurrection can this happen. I have now a song that I'd like to play. It's a very powerful song. It has the words on the screen, so you'll be able to follow it. The song is called Hymn of Heaven, and it's by Phil Wickham. I'll just let you listen to it now.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all faith, we sang through doubt and fear. In the end, we'll see that it was worth it when He returns to wipe away our tears. Oh.
As we travel through life, and each one of us has a different path or story as represented in this photo, we can all be sure or have assurance that we do have a future, not a hazy or unknown future, but a future of eternal life in heaven and the new earth made new. Death is not the end. We are a citizen of heaven. Let's pray. Father in heaven, in the name of our Saviour, Jesus, we thank you for the sacrifice and resurrection that you made for us on Calvary. And because of the resurrection, we know we have a future of no more pain nor sorrow, where we will see you face to face and give glory to you, who gave us life beyond the grave. Lord, forgive us. Help all of us, Lord, to confess our sins and each one of us choose to be saved by your grace. Help us, Lord, to accept you as our Saviour. Make us clean and prepare us for heaven to live with you forever. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.